welcome. I'm Diana J. Coakes, your host on Helping Hands, a show where we highlight people and organizations who are making a difference in our community. And today I'm really happy to welcome to the studio Angela Oftenberg, President and CEO of Vista Maria. So welcome.
Thank you. It's good to be here, Diana.
Vista Maria has a very long and successful history in southeastern Michigan. I understand it was founded about 130 years ago by the Sisters of the Good Shepherd. Many of the social services agencies in the area, I think, have an order of Catholic nuns somewhere in their founding days. So why don't you tell me a little bit about Vista Maria, its history, and kind of bring us up to date with what's going on with your organization now.
Sure, I'm happy to. Vista Maria, as you mentioned, was founded by the Sisters of Good Shepherd. They're an order of sisters who started in France, and their mission was to care for vulnerable children and women, to help them restore and to thrive in community. When they came to the Detroit area, it was in 1883, and they were in downtown Detroit. And they created a home for orphans as well as unwed mothers. And they, at the center of everything that they do is care and treatment, but with a very strong focus on education. The belief is that you can end poverty, abuse, and neglect through education. Today, Vista Maria is an organization that has a variety of different programs, from residential treatment to in-community foster homes and foster families and adoption, to high schools, to after-school programming, as well as what we call transitional living program and life skills development for homeless young women in the community. We care for about 400 teenagers in a day through our variety of programs, and we're located in Dearborn Heights on a 37-acre campus.
So Vista Maria really has brought kind of the mission into the modern age, because I know there are a lot of influences in society that really prey on young and vulnerable citizens. In reading the information about your organization, I know that you treat and work with from birth to age 25,
yes,
both boys and girls.
Yes.
And it's the members of our society that have been the victim of some kind of abuse or trauma or neglect, which then, as it turns out, leads to other problems, drug abuse and exploitation, sexual exploitation. So I think one of the areas that I understand Vista Maria really has begun to champion is work with victims of human sex trafficking,
yes,
which has become, unfortunately, a very prevalent problem. And I understand that sadly, Michigan ranks as the second highest incidence,
yes,
of human trafficking in the nation.
Yes.
So let's talk a little bit about that, why it has come to be, what some of the influences are that are snaring young people into this really unfortunate lifestyle, and what Vista Maria is doing to help.
Sure. I'll back up a little with our different programs first. We work with what we call at-risk children from all over the state of Michigan, but primarily focused on Wayne, Oakland, and Macomb counties. And at-risk children can be children from impoverished communities, broken families, families that have to move a lot because of situations with lack of employment or eviction from their home. And so they're a little unstable and in tragedy, trying to overcome the adversity of the economic conditions that are surrounding the family. So our programs are all about wrapping around, when we can, biological family. But if that's not possible because of abuse and neglect, then our programming is focused on keeping kids in community and foster families and looking for ways of reunification or adoption. When those aren't the options that are available and the situation, to your point earlier, is so severe that the trauma is so deep that that young girl in these cases is not able to stay in the community and she needs some more intensive mental health treatment, then she can live on our campus, and that's our mental health residential treatment programs. We have about 120 girls in a variety of different treatment programs on campus. Related to trafficking, we have over the years served many girls who have been victims of sexual exploitation. Human trafficking comes in one of two forms. It can be labor trafficking, forced labor, unpaid, forced hours, or it can be sexual exploitation, commercial sexual exploitation. In our cases, in Michigan, because of lack of protocols and reportings in the past, many children would come to us in care for other reasons. It could be mental health and substance abuse, but then through treatment and care, that girl starts to begin to trust. And then you find that she's been trafficked, and that's what led to the trauma, that's what led to the addiction, that's what led to the homelessness.
Because very often in sexual trafficking situations, drugs sometimes play a very prominent role in the beginning, because the victim is then drugged, pulled into this damaging lifestyle, and then trapped both by addiction now and the economics of their situation.
Yes. Many of your viewers and many people throughout the United States believe that human trafficking is only applies to foreign-born children and women. And that certainly is a global issue, but it is also an issue, as you mentioned, in the state of Michigan. These are domestic-born children. The average age of enticement, and I'm going to use that word enticement, into trafficking for boys is 9 to 12, and for girls is 12 to 14. Now, children at that age don't even understand what sexual exploitation is, and they are enticed. They are promised things. They don't even know what they're being promised for. It might be, I promise to take care of you. I promise you won't have to go to school. I promise that I will give you things. I'll buy you. We had one young girl tell us, well, I got a Coach purse every month. And it is subtle. So for your viewers, it can be traffickers waiting in the malls to see girls who should be in school and are skipping, and they will befriend them and position themselves as a boyfriend. That will go on for months, but then there will be the payback time. And you mentioned earlier, many times they're drugged for quite a bit of time to create the addiction and or to get that young person in a state that they can be sexually exploited.
And a lot of the victims are homeless. So I think there is a very telling statistic that for runaways, one in three will be approached by a trafficker within 36 hours of being on the street. That's a pretty remarkable number.
Yes, in the United States, they've confirmed that one in three children who run away will be approached by a trafficker. And again, children don't understand. We don't have the word out in schools to say, this is what a trafficker will do, or this is what it looks like. Or if your friend starts hanging out with other people then that are older and seem to be pulling her or him away from school, that's when your radar should be up about something going on and that it's not, it could be trafficking.
And so these traffickers are really preying on the most vulnerable members of our society, young, with family issues, on the street, no support group, lack of education, now they're getting into drugs, and it just becomes a really terrible downward spiral. And I'm sure the girls and boys, as you mentioned, end up feeling when they're in the midst of this that there's no way out and they have no options, because not only are they being trafficked, but the coercion extends to threatening to do harm to their family, or if you don't keep doing this, we'll get your younger sister. And
yes.
So now they feel not only are they trapped, but that they can't escape because it will bring harm to other people.
So it starts very subtly, and it is those ages of children are enticed because they don't know what a healthy and loving relationship is like. Mm-hmm. And so they're a little bit, to use the non-technical term, they're brainwashed.
Sure.
And they can have attachment disorders to their traffickers. Mm-hmm. They can have a false sense of love. They can suffer from post-traumatic stress. They are, because they don't know what a healthy relationship is, they are actually taught by the traffickers that this is what you will do mm-hmm. if you love me. Mm-hmm. And so your that mental paradigm mm-hmm. in those young person's head is not what you and I would consider to be a normal, mm-hmm. healthy relationship for a 16-year-old, 17-year-old. The average age, I mentioned earlier about coming into trafficking, but the average duration is 6 to 7 years. So if you can imagine being enticed at the age of 12 as a female, but not being out of being trafficked till 18, those are very formative years.
Sure.
And so now you're talking about a situation where, her mindset about what a relationship should be and her sexuality and her social and emotional development is all impaired.
Mm-hmm. And that's a lifetime of trying to fix, to correct what has been such a damaging early life experience, which is why I think Vista Maria really serves such an important need. You know, you mentioned that a lot of these young people are enticed by someone who purports to be their boyfriend, or I'm going to take care of you, or here's, on just the commercial level of off giving them presents and things
yes.
that maybe in their own circumstance they never would be able to afford. So there's this sense of slowly bringing them in. But also, isn't it true that some trafficking really is not just the notion of cultivating a victim, but actually they are the victim of kidnapping, where they
yes.
are physically
held.
Taken and held, and that's a really significant part of what's happening in this realm as well, is it not?
Yes, so it starts subtly as a promise of a better life. That can happen both with labor trafficking as well as commercial sex trafficking. It starts very subtly as a promise of things to be better mm-hmm. and its enticement. To your point, it changes. And then it's, if you leave, I will turn you in to the police, I will kill you, I'll kill your family, I'll kill your siblings, I will go and recruit your little sister or your little brother. So then that young person feels compelled to stay. It's not a physical bond, but it is a mental and psychological bond mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. that, we always think that they're kidnapped and they, as soon as they get a chance, they're gonna run away and they're gonna be out in the streets like
right.
the women in Ohio. It's not like that. It is very subtle, and it is that social and psychological entrapment mm-hmm. and bondage that you're talking about
yeah.
that occurs.
This is just such a difficult but important topic. It's
yes.
hard to believe that it's going on really in our own community, in our own state. We're going to take just a short break right now, and when we come back, Angela is going to talk a little bit more about what Vista Maria is doing to help people who have been trapped by this lifestyle. So stay with us. We'll be right back. Thank you.
Thank you. Big dreams and good grades aren't enough to get into college. There are actual steps you need to take. Finding someone who can help is the first and most important. For the next steps, go to knowhowtogo.org.
Welcome back. My guest today is Angela Oftenberg from the Vista Maria organization, and we've been talking about a situation that I think a lot of people want to believe isn't happening in our area, but unfortunately it is, sex trafficking of young people. It's a sad problem, it's a pervasive problem, but luckily organizations like Vista Maria do have some support and are offering victims of sex trafficking a way out and some yes. options. So let's talk a little bit about how Vista Maria is helping.
Sure. First of all, a little known fact is we have a program where we treat refugee children, and we've been doing that for many years. We can have children come via Caribbean or South American countries through states like Texas, be picked up in a raid, and then need and are referred for treatment at facilities like Vista Maria. And what we try to do first in that treatment is create bonds of trust and care. Many trafficked victims don't trust authority figures. They've been brainwashed to not, no one is here to help you, only the trafficker. Mm-hmm. So you have to slowly, patiently, regain their trust and let them know, you know, even when they're angry with you or having a bad day, calling you names, that you still are there, you're not going anywhere. Once you gain that trust, then you can start to move into treatment. And treatment is that decomposing the trauma and getting it in a place where that child can process that she didn't do anything to deserve that. Mm-hmm. She is not a bad girl. She's had bad things happen to her. Mm-hmm. Or the same thing for a young boy. They generally will process that they've done something to deserve this, and they don't see themselves as a victim, and you have to help them reframe that thinking that's been brainwashed into them for years and years and years. You have to undo that.
Now, is this done in a residential setting?
Our programs primarily are in a residential placement. The children stay with us 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Once we can work into treatment for the young person, though, we can start, if there's biological family, to incorporate family therapy mm-hmm. and then reunite. Vista Maria is one of our main processes and premises is reunification whenever possible with biological family or kin. We will always do that. In some cases, they're not interested or available or identified, and then what we're trying to do is create other types of permanency plans
so
for our young people.
So foster care.
Exactly.
Okay.
We do have some children who have been trafficked who go into our treatment foster families, and these families are very well trained, very loving, and we wrap around those families and those situations in the community 24/7 and help with everything from therapy to behavior aids. So our treatment programming is all about that first half of gaining trust, then looking at the situation and helping that young person understand it. Then we can start to talk about family, and then life skills, and eventually what we call community reintegration, whether that's with a foster family, mm-hmm. biological family, and for older young people, you know, 18, 19-year-olds that don't have family to go back to, they may be without family, or the family situation is not supportive mm-hmm. of their mm-hmm. Rehabilitation, then what we talk about is our transitional living program, which is called Shepherd Hall.
And that's on campus in
Yes, Dearborn, that
right?
is.
So now on staff, you have social workers, psychologists? What? Let's talk a little bit about the professional services that they provide.
No, that's a great question because Vista Maria is very unique. First of all, we have two adolescent psychiatrists on staff and available to us 24/7. Most agencies in the state don't have that kind of high level of therapeutic care. Mm-hmm. In addition to that, all of our program managers are master's prepared. All of our therapists are master's prepared. And then each of our young ladies who are in our programming are also assigned a bachelor's prepared counselor. Mm. So we also have a health services and a medical clinic right on campus. So you can tell we're very comprehensive and interdisciplinary in our care and treatment of our kids.
Now there is an actual school
on
the campus, the Clara B. Ford
Academy.
And that is for your residents who are high school age or?
Middle school and high school. Well, on campus, we have girls that run from age 11 to 18, 19 years old. Mm-hmm. And again, I mentioned to you back in from the very beginning, the Sisters of Good Shepherd education is the way to lift yourself up and out of poverty mm-hmm. and change your history, right? Yeah. Break that cycle for yourself and for your future generations. And that's what Vista Maria is all about, right? Creating change one person at a time.
And it's not, if I could just interrupt for a second, it's not just extricating them from the problem, but it's providing them a path to a better future.
Yes.
And I think that children who age out of the foster care system, which is at 18.
It's 21, actually.
Oh, it's 21 now?
Yes, in the state, yes.
Okay, but there is a gap there because your services go up to 25.
24, 25, yes. Mm-hmm.
So that then there's also that little bit of a buffer period for these older, clients who now need that just little extra support.
Yes, it's very interesting. So many of our young girls who come into care, let's take this example of residential treatment. Mm-hmm. And in a particular girl story, let's just suppose she's trafficked by a gang. So, you know, she has a bad home situation. She truants from school. She gets enticed, and now she's part of this gang, okay? And I'm just trying to give your viewers a little bit of a story. She innocently, is got a boyfriend. She's still going. Now she goes back to school. But over time, part of her job is when the guys go out and their job is to steal cars, her job is to sexually serve the guys when they come back. That's trafficking, right? And she is enticed and she is coerced and it's, fraudulent. She is, and they threaten, right? Her, or maybe her siblings, maybe her family, and she is coerced slowly, over time. She comes to Vista Maria, let's say, and she receives treatment, and she does very well in our treatment program, which generally run about 4 to 5 months, maybe a little bit longer. And now she's 17 years old, but she's not graduated from high school, and there isn't family to reunify with. Our programs at Vista Maria can create that bridge. Not only Clara B. Ford Academy allows a student to, once they're out of treatment, to come back as a continuing student, which is why we created Clara B. Ford Academy. Mm-hmm. What's different about our school is all of our teachers are trauma-informed. We run 15 students to one teacher, and we wrap around that child because success is a high school diploma. In addition to that, we created the Shepherd Hall Transitional Living Program. That is where these young women are in an open program. They have their own apartment, a little dorm-style apartment, mm-hmm. nothing lavish, but she can continue to get life skills. Many 17, 18, 19-year-olds don't know how to clean, don't know how to wash clothes, don't know about banking, don't know about cashing their check. They've never had a job. Our program is to keep them in school, to have an education plan, as well as a career plan and a life coach, as well as mentors that help her continue on that journey to transition to a successful adult adulthood. Vista Maria is all about successful adulthood.
And that must be really satisfying for you and for all of the members of your organization to see young women and men pulled from such a damaging lifestyle on a path to a much more successful future. So what can the general public do to help?
Sure. We have many opportunities, and it ranges. So if you're compelled by our mission and our message at Vista Maria, they should go visit our website, which is www.vistamaria.org. There's many opportunities, but let me spend a minute. There are events, and it can be a one-time event where you're giving our kids an opportunity to be kids and, you know, decorate Easter eggs or dress up and have a fashion show or have a spa day in our programs. We do things like that, and we need volunteers. Beyond that, we have needs for tutors. We have needs for mentors. Many of our young people do not have a positive adult influence in their life and someone who expects great things from them. And that creates hope and promise for our kids. We also have opportunities for folks who want to help out by getting awareness and of the needs for at-risk and foster children, as well as victims of trafficking. And there are also opportunities for folks who want to lend their professional body of knowledge as advisors to the board
and
of directors.
And I'm sure there are also opportunities to donate money to help.
Absolutely.
Always in a wonderful cause like this.
Yes.
I understand that there are, and we just have a couple of minutes to wrap up, but I understand that there is some legislation now making its way through the state legislature that is focused specifically on this problem. Would you like to just talk about that a little bit?
Yes, and the problem being human trafficking. In the state of Michigan, our legislation doesn't create a series of connected legislation that actually allows for care and treatment of victims of trafficking. One of the most promising is a House bill, 5021, and it is create safe harbor. So that legislation currently in draft says that any one child picked up under the age of 18 for prostitution or commercial sexual activity is presumed to be a victim of trafficking. And so Vista Maria, who is very victim-centered, prefers that legislation. And then the second piece is there is a second bill that is 5026 that requires treatment for victims of human trafficking through legislation. Because today, if a child is picked up in a raid, they are not required to be treated.
So they were just released back into the environment that caused the problem in the first place.
Yes.
No safety net, no...
And if the police cannot identify family, those young people, 16, 17, can be right back in a shelter, which can then create
the
cycle all over.
And then it's just a vicious circle, and they're back where they started.
Yes. Because they have no means to care for themselves, right? And then they go back to exactly what they know. Trafficking is organized crime, and there are many... The best of the best traffickers tell these young children and women what they have to do if they get picked up and where they will meet again. Mm-hmm. And if they don't come and meet, they will go and hurt family or friends or something bad will happen.
Well, that's why an organization like Vista Maria is just so important for providing a safety net and support and services that will help these victims extricate themselves from the lifestyle and then find a way to lead a more fulfilling, safe, whole, healthy
life.
So, Angela, I really appreciate you being with us today. You have a very compelling story to tell, and I hope our viewers will take a moment and go to www.vistamaria.org to learn more about this really important work. So I thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
Thank you for being with us today, and we'll see you again next time on Helping Hands.